I had a skiffle group which was mainly made up of school friends, and it wasn't very good, to be honest, but we just enjoyed ourselves. Bruce was also in a skiffle group, which was a much more professional outfit, commercially orientated, earning money, that sort of stuff.
Both at school, I have to say, this is.
Yeah, and we met because Bruce had brought a guitar to school, a National Steel, which intrigued me tremendously. I mean, just the fact there was a guitar at school, but this metal-bodied guitar. And once we sort of expressed a mutual interest in music, and I found out that Bruce had this group, and then I was invited to join the group. They needed someone who could play sort of lead guitar and another singer for harmonies and things. So that's what happened. Then we start doing little clubs, didn't we? Working men's clubs, you know, go as you pleases, which is a kind of talent competition. In other words, you turn up, do what you want. 5 minute spot, and the audience votes. And if you win, you get like a fiver. Second gets £3 or something. Third, £2, whatever. And we did that sort of work, little, still supposed to be at school doing homework, but in fact, we weren't doing homework. We were gigging.
Hank's group was the Crescent City.
Crescent City, yes.
Crescent City Skiffle Group, and the group I was in was the Railroaders Skiffle Group. And the we'd seen an advert for a talent competition in London somehow, which was at the Granada Edmonton in the first week of April the 6th of 1958. And you and I were 16, weren't we?
Yeah.
I think a Malaysian opera singer won. And a trad band came second, and the Railroaders, I think, we came third. And funny enough, on that particular day, there was a group playing called The Velvets, and Brian Bennett was the drummer on The Velvets, and he had a great sound on his snare drum. I think he had a duster or something.
Yeah.
And we remembered him from that day. Anyway, the two other guys in the band, so we lost the competition, the two other guys in the band said we're going home. And I think they did the next day, or?
Yeah, they went back to
and Hank work. And I decided to stay in London. But the Two Eyes, I guess, became famous in 56, really, with Tommy Steele. That's when I first heard of it. Tommy Steele had allegedly been discovered singing in this coffee bar. And, you know, the great story about Tommy was that he was a seaman, he was on leave on the merchant ships, and he was singing down this little coffee bar, and a guy came up to him and said, "I'm going to make you a star, son." He said, "Well, you've got 2 weeks because I'm back in the boats in 2 weeks' time." And anyway, you know, a bit of folklore, and Tommy was, and that's when I first heard of it, and this, it became like a place for what I guess you'd call it wannabes now, wannabe a star.
Sort of a mecca.
And it was only like a cavern, like the cavern, I suppose, small coffee bar. Frothy coffee, you know, the old Italian coffee, which we hadn't seen in Newcastle, I don't
know.
It was the place. We met so many people. We would get up and jam, you know, can I get up and do a couple of numbers with you? We were the Geordie boys, you know. And it was there that we got to know Brian Bennett, and Tony Meehan got up with us, Jet Harris. Licorice Locking was down there. It was a mecca for would-be musos, you know.
Yeah. We used to play down there, probably 5-6 nights a week. And one night when we weren't playing, I actually was ill, I had cold or something, and Bruce was down there working, and he came back and told me that he'd seen this group down there with a great, she's a great singer. It looks a bit like Elvis, you know, dark, good-looking kid, sounds good, you know.
Yeah.
We didn't know who it was, and it was only later on that maybe 2 months later, we found out it was Cliff. I was hanging around one day at the Two Eyes with a guy called Rick Richards, who was a country and western singer. We were just chatting, and this guy came in, a guy called John Foster, who was Cliff's first manager. So Rick said, "Why don't you have a listen to Hank?" And I was a little bit embarrassed about the whole thing. And Rick said, "Come on, let's get the guitars out." So fortunately, we had our guitars downstairs in the cellar. Went downstairs, and Rick sang a few things, a few Elvis songs and a couple of Buddy Hollies, and I played guitar. And John said, "That's great. If you want the job, you've got it." It was just a 2-week tour. So I said, "Do you need a rhythm guitarist?" He said, "Well, yeah, we do, actually." And so I recommended Bruce. Then John said, "Well, look, we're going to have a rehearsal in a couple of days' time at Cliff's parents' place. So we'll meet here at the Two Eyes on whatever day it was." And that was it. We, a couple of days later, we met Cliff, actually, at the tailor's, just along from the Two Eyes. There was a tailor shop. And Cliff was being fitted for this famous pink jacket, which looked great. And it was quite outrageous at the time. And that's when we first met.
We just had spots, didn't we?
Pimples. Yeah, we all had spots. I mean, we're just an acneed team, you know.
Pimple kids.
The first rehearsals we did with Cliff were in his parents' front room in Cheshunt. There was Bruce, Cliff, Terry Smart, a school friend of Cliff's on drums, Ian Samwell, who wrote Move It and a few of other Cliff's other early hits, on bass guitar, myself, and that, and we just practiced in the front room. I think it was only doing five numbers or something. I think there was an initial period of suspicion, you know, eyeing each other up and down, you know, who does he think he is and this sort of stuff. But we got into a conversation on the bus. We found out we had similar senses of humour. We liked the Goons and other things. Bridget Bardot, Marilyn Monroe came to mind, you know, et cetera, et cetera, and male film stars that we perhaps admired. So we very quickly found that we had quite a lot in common, plus music, of course. That was the important thing. We were on the same wavelength musically. And that was it. And we were off. And very quickly, during that tour, we struck up a good friendship and became more like a band rather than a singer and backing musicians. And that's really the way it was for most of the time we were together.
Mm. We shared a flat in Marylebone High Street, yeah?
Yeah.
12 guineas a week. Cliff, Hank and myself, £4 each.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it was a big flat. It was like, I don't know, four beds, three baths, that sort of, you know, big. And big enough to rehearse in the front room, or look as though we're rehearsing. Tony's he's got a drum kit there, hasn't he?
Yeah.
Behind you.
Well, yeah.
Very central.
At least a snare drum and a hi-hat, I think, yeah.
And it must have been early 59.
And that was before Cliff got his back straightened.
Yes. Was Cliff Richard and the Drifters.
That's right.
For about 6 months, I guess?
Well, yeah, until summer of 59.
Yeah.
And what had happened was that Cliff's records were being released in America, Cliff Richard and the Drifters. No, you can't do it. The American Drifters, unreasonably, you know, here we were for 5 minutes, called the Drifters. They'd only had the name for 25 years. And we came up with names like the Four Jets and things like this. And in fact, I believe there's a record put out.
There is.
In America, Jets, the Four Jets, which was us. And Jet Harris and myself were on our motor scooters in Ruislip. Lido,
was
Lido,
it a pub?
Lido, Lido, what do you call it?
Lido, man.
Lido?
Hey, Lido.
Where I come from, Newcastle, it's a Lido. And we were having a lager and lime, big drinkers. And Jet suddenly came, we were talking about the name, and he suddenly came up with this concept of the Shadows. And we thought, that sounds good. It had, it's quite evocative of the situation, Cliff, we're behind him, but also slightly mysterious. So well, we went back and told the guys, they all liked it, Cliff liked it, told our record producer, he liked it, and that was it. We used to sing, Bruce and I, in harmonies, a bit sort of in the Everly Brothers style, I suppose, and singing with Cliff. And Cliff had heard us sing a few songs. In fact, it got the stage on his shows. Remember, the production got better to the extent that he would do...
a second jacket.
Exactly, he'd do a few numbers, we'd sing a song, and he'd go off and come up with a different colour jacket on. He'd say, this is big stuff. And he said, look, you guys should be recording, you know, writing the stuff and singing. So he spoke to Norrie and said, I think you should give them an audition.
Norrie Paramore was already a famous band leader. He was a pianist to start with.
Yeah.
In Harry Gold's Pieces of Eight. So he was a pianist. Now, I'm trying to figure out how old Norrie would have been when we were 16, 17.
Late 30s, probably.
Yeah, on the way to
maybe
40,
early
maybe.
40s.
So he felt like your dad. He felt like a much older man.
We went to the office in Castle Street, was it? Castle Street, EMI office. Took guitars, amplifiers and a drum kit in this office. Norrie sat behind the desk. We set up.
And played.
And
it
we
from,
played.
Can you imagine doing it now?
A few songs and sang. And he said, you've got yourselves a recording contract.
Yeah.
The good thing, as Bruce was saying about Norrie, was that I think he didn't completely understand what was going on with us. He knew it had an appeal. It was very simple, probably, from his standpoint, musically. And he didn't interfere too much. We'd go away, work it out, arrange it, come back, play it. And as long as we recorded three sides in a session, and he was happy as Larry.
Happy as Norrie.
Happy as Norrie. Yeah. He was very shrewd, I think, in that sense, and think, well, hey, I don't completely understand this, but it works. Mm. Don't fix it. Feeling fine, stole a kiss. Feeling fine, a pretty miss. Gave it back, and so I'm feeling fine. And so on. very fast, very frenetic.
See why I didn't make it, eh?
Yeah. We did it on the Old Boy show, I think, didn't
yeah,
we?
Yeah, Old Boy, yeah.
And
wiggling our legs.
It did, nothing happened to it, you know. It didn't get much promotion, didn't go. The next one was an instrumental called Driftin', and actually it was Jet Black was
Jet
the
Black,
A-side,
yeah.
that Jet Harris wrote.
And Driftin', which you wrote?
Which I wrote, yeah. They were both and very derivative, sort of Duane Eddy-type things, you know.
And then Saturday Dance was the third single. Vocal group.
What
which Hank wrote. And Saturday Dance nearly made it. It nearly made the top 30, I think, in those days. So that would still be late 59.
And that gave us a lot of confidence, I think, that encouragement, that it was almost a hit.
Maybe also, the first single with the Straton.
Yeah.
Cliff and ourselves and Hank, we were really into America, you know, Buddy Holly and the Blue Cap, Gene Vincent and Ricky Nelson especially, his guitar player. And obviously they played America. Their records sounded great, and the solo, and the lead guitars always sounded great. Mm. And we didn't know his name at the time. We loved Ricky Nelson's guitarist, who is now James Burton, of course, or was then as well.
Yeah.
And we'd seen Buddy Holly. We'd seen the photograph of Buddy with this guitar that looked like a spaceship, you know. We didn't know what it was. So Cliff, big star, he said, he sent to America, to California, to the Fender factory. We found out it was a Fender, for the brochure. And the brochure came back, you know. I always love, Mark Knopfler says, he saw the brochure as well. He can remember the smell of the brochure. It was just, you know, because it was that important in those days. Mm. And we were flicking through, you know, we went through the little brochure, and there was a Broadway or whatever it was, and a Telecaster, and then it came to the centre page, and there was this pink Stratocaster with a maple neck with gold-plated hardware, you know, and it was, wow. And to cut a long story short, Cliff bought it. He imported this guitar, Fender Stratocaster, for Hank to play.
Yeah, the funny thing was, it worked out really well, that, first of all, this guitar, this Strat, we could see it was the same shape as the one Buddy Holly had, so we thought, well, that's the same one. And surely James Burton uses the same guitar, because it's the most expensive one on the range. So anyway, when this thing arrived with this tremolo arm on, it had the heaviest strings you could imagine on there. You couldn't bend them. They're like horses, you know, steel horses. And I thought, particularly James Burton used to bend around a lot, great stuff. And I genuinely thought that it must be the American diet. You know, with all this steak and eggs and milk, these guys must have incredibly powerful fingers, you see, that can bend these strings. And I genuinely believed that, because none of us had heard of light gauge strings in those days. They didn't exist in the UK. So, and it wasn't until a couple of years later, we found out that, in fact, he didn't use a Strat anyway. He used a Tele with extremely light strings on. But I'm glad, in a way, that we got the Stratocaster, because from my standpoint, that was a huge component in developing the style.
Yeah, your trademark.
The tremolo arm.
Yeah.
And developing a sort of vibrato using that, because you couldn't do it in the heavy strings, and no one was doing vibratos then anyway.
This guitar was 140 guineas. 140 guineas. A bargain.
At 1959, Bruce, in Leeds, doing a week in variety at Leeds, and we were sitting down after a show considering how we could improve the
presentation. Yeah.
And coincidentally, Bruce, myself, and Cliff, unbeknown to us, had gone to see Jerry Lee Lewis in the Savoy, Burnt Oak, I think it was, with a backing, not his backing band, a support band called the Treniers, black band, Fender bass, sax player, keyboard, couple of vocalists. And the interesting thing was that this R&B band used to do all these great movements together. And we got to think about that and thought, well, why can't we do something like that? So we thought, okay. And we were putting a new number in that week. It was called Willie and the Hand Jive. And Cliff was on the centre mic. We'd come either side, do the little interjections and the harmonies. And then came the solo. And we worked this routine out where we all walked back in unison and started walking sort of diagonally, a kick, back, front, a kick, et cetera, during the solo.
We were the Tiller Girls.
And I tell you what, we worked this thing out, and it was quite difficult to play and do all this at once, but we stuck it in the show, and it brought the house down. And we thought, hey, this has got to be the direction. So we gradually added more and more stuff to it.
I mean, obviously, Cliff had all the adulation. He was the, you know, the star, if you like. We were just having so much fun, weren't we? The concerts were a riot. We used to purposely make him wiggle his legs a bit more so we could have a riot, you know.
Yeah.
And he was doing all the... And you couldn't hear him anyway. It was like, this is, you know, years before Beatlemania. You know, it was Cliffmania or Tommy Steelmania before that. You know, the girls just screamed and we were just... We used to wiggle our legs and I used to lay on my back during a solo and play rhythm on... And then I'd say to Hank... Can you play rhythm while I get up? I couldn't get up and play rhythm at the same time.
Yeah.
Ridiculous.
Yeah, it was a pretty chaotic sort of presentation through that period, wasn't it? Every man for himself. If there was a piano there, you'd climb on it, you know, and Jet Harris would move to the front of the stage and glare at all the guys and and things like that. It was a very weird thing. But I think one thing that helped us, certainly probably from 59 onwards, was that we had... older people around us, like Sid Morris, from the Greats organization, who were then Cliff's agent. Very experienced tour manager, worked with a lot of big names, both British and American, and therefore not impressed by a few guys who've got girls screaming at them. And people like that around you are very good for keeping you on your feet. I remember Bruce one time saying to David Bryce, somebody else, maybe you said, listen, man, I'm a star. And David said, well, twinkle, twinkle.
Yeah, I was 17 then.
Yeah, and it's great, you see, because that kind of... And then we, in 1960, we got a manager for the Shads. So as things moved forward, we always had people around us who were older, more experienced, and
kept us,
and,
in check,
and
really.
Kept us really
on the
feet
straight
on the floor.
Now. Yeah, yeah.
Jerry Lorden.
We met Jerry on this tour in April of 1960.
He came up to Jet myself after one show and said, "What are you guys going to do any more recordings?" And we said, "Well, yes, we're due to record when we finish this tour." He said, "What are you going to do, instrumentals or vocals?" We said, "Well, we don't really know. We're going to try to write something. Doesn't really matter. Whatever comes easiest." And he said, "Well, can I play you an instrumental that I've written?" And we said, "Yeah." And he... out of a small bag, he produced this little ukulele. And he went jink diddling, jink 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 diddling diddling, down 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 diddling, and so on.
And he said, "No, Jim, we don't like it."
And enthralled with his piece. And we thought, this is very classy, simple, but classy instrumental. Mm. So we got Bruce and Tony. Listen to it. Yeah. Played it to Norrie Paramore. He loved it. We arranged it before we did that because there's no arrangement. It's just a straight tune.
Norrie had already earmarked our next single, which was the Old Army Song.
Oh, Quartermaster.
I'm never sure whether it's Quartermaster. It is Quartermaster.
We call it. I thought we called it Quatermasters at the time.
Yeah, but it was Quartermasters. You know, as in the army.
Yeah.
And so we took it to Norrie, and he said, "Okay, but I want you to do Quartermaster Stores," and we recorded both the tunes and. Of course, Apache was quite unique then with the echo box and all that stuff. And it was just a great melody. And Norrie was quite keen on Quartermaster Stores being the A side. And we sort of said, oh. And we'd heard this story that Norrie, when he made Move It with Cliff, Schoolboy Crush was going to be the A side. And Move It was obviously fantastic. And Norrie said, he said this to Cliff, he said, "I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll take it home to my daughters and play it to them." And the daughters chose Move It. And he said the same thing with her. She said, "I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll take it home and play it to my girls." And the girls chose Apache. And he said, "Okay."
Thank goodness.
Thank goodness. Yeah.
You know, obviously we had the number one. Lots of people in those days did pantomimes. It was quite common. We did Cliff and the Shads in 1959. 60 did 3 weeks in pantomime in Stockton and Hull. Yours did 2 weeks in Stockton and a week in Hull. We did it ourselves in 1961, I think, end of 61, same thing. And the only other pantomimes we did were the ones at the Palladium. We wrote the music for three.
And appeared in two.
The first one, Cliff and ourselves were in, which was Aladdin. Was it?
Yeah.
Aladdin. And then Frank Ifield did Babes in the Wood. We wrote the music for that, all original music. Then we did the third in the series, which was what?
Cinderella.
Yeah.
But the Palladium was the most famous theatre in the world and probably still is. And we would do 16 weeks at a stretch there. But more important, we wrote the scores. So in 1964 and 66 and 65 for Frank Ifield, that was a big deal to do that.
We were able to write songs for the movies and we had hits from the movies. So, you know, from that standpoint, it was good business. But also from the public's standpoint, we became more enormous in their eyes in the sense we're now film stars. You're not really a film star, of course, but you're in movies. And it takes you into another dimension, if you like. So I think it was a good move. Cliff had hits, obviously, from things like Espresso Bongo. He had hits from that. Shrine on the Second Floor, I think, wasn't it?
Voice in the Wilderness?
Voice in the Wilderness. So we didn't have anything. We just had one instrumental in that, but that was just part of an EP package, a thing called Chinchilla, I think, that Norrie Paramore wrote, funnily enough. And in The Young Ones, we wrote some songs for that, and, of course, we had the hit with The Savage, which, again, Norrie wrote.
Peace Pipe was from the same thing.
Yeah, and Cliff obviously had the hit with The Young Ones, and we wrote a song called We Say Yeah, which became a big sort of favourite, stage favourite at the time. Mm-hmm. The Summer Holiday, Bruce and Brian wrote the title song, Summer Holiday. We had Foot Tapper, which we wrote for that movie. It was a number one for us.
Yeah.
And a few other little bits and pieces in the movie that we wrote. So, you know, all together it worked pretty well. And then we had a movie called Wonderful Life. And what did we have from that? I'm trying to think. We had some
on the beach.
On the beach. Yeah, where I forgot. Yeah. It was a hit from that. And
on the beach.
And then Finders Keepers. We got an Ivor Novello Award for a song called Time Drags By that we did as an ensemble song with Cliff, obviously taking lead, but lots of harmonies. And on that song, when we recorded, here's a little bit of info. When we did this song, we felt it needed a kind of bluesy harmonica, and we asked our engineer if he knew of anyone who could come in at short notice to Abbey Road, and he rang around, and this guy, we knew him, by the way, turned up with a bag full of harmonicas. And this guy's normally known as a guitarist, but he played great harmonica. And this guy called Jimmy Page.
Yeah. He's done quite well since.
He's done well, yeah.
Yeah. You know, you're talking about 1963. This is nearly 5 years we'd been going before the Beatles arrived.
And I don't know about you, Bruce, but I'd always felt that the bubble at some point would burst instrumentally, particularly with singles. It usually does for any artist, and I know there are some notable exceptions who've just continued to have hit after hit. So when that came on the scene, I found it exciting, the music they were making and the sound they were making. I liked the quality of the songs, the rawness of the production, and because I felt that music was getting, pop music was getting very sweet. It was following the American movement. And we were doing it really ourselves. Yeah. And the hardness that used to be in our music was beginning to drift away, if it hadn't already. So they came along with this new hardness, getting back to the roots of rock and roll. Yeah. Exciting. But funnily enough, that year, Bruce, was one of our biggest years for single sales. Elvis was the biggest record seller in the world that year. No, Cliff. Elvis second and we were third.
Yeah.
That was pretty good. So we had two number ones or three number ones that year, number twos, a couple of number twos. Big year and big album and everything. So, but we could see the writing on the wall that this new trend was going to get bigger. And it did, didn't it? All the new groups came on the scene.
Most of the groups used to meet, whether it was TV shows, or Top of the Pops, whatever it was, or the famous, more likely, the Blue Boar on the M1 at 1 o'clock or 2 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah, we actually went to see them at one of those Granadas.
Tooting, wherever it was. Yeah.
They were third on the bill. Tommy Rowe, Chris Montez, and the Beatles. It's half empty, no screams.
Yeah.
And they were great. I thought they were great. Sounded good, it was exciting, and they had a bit of that humour in their act, you know, and people laughed at it. And we went up to see them afterwards, and we walked up the stairs, and John was leaning back with his glasses on, and he whipped them off straight away. because they were very similar to the ones I used to wear in those days, and it just made me smile. And someone said later on that he hates people. Sometimes people say, you look like Hank Marvin, and he hates it, and he takes his glasses off, you see. And we had a great chat with him, and was it that night we went to your place?
Yeah, the party. I had a party at my place, yeah. They all came back, you know.
Yeah, and we got the guitars out, a lot of fun. And
we knew they were going to be enormous. I mean, it was obvious they were going to be enormous. Love Me Do, and then Please Please Me.
We were in Abbey Road once, and Paul came in and said, I've got a little tune you might like. Can I play it? We said, yeah. And he sat at the piano, and he went, down, down, da 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 dee 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 dee, and so on. We said, oh, that's lovely. Oh, he said, look, I tell you what, can I put it on a cassette and send it in to you? We said, yeah. Right. That was the end of the story. You never heard from him again. And the next Beatles album came out, and it was on. There was a song here, there, and everywhere. Yeah, that was as close as we got to having a Beatles composition for us.
We did a charity show at the Palladium, the famous Palladium, and Cliff and the Shads, and Billy Cotton Jr. was there, who was head of the BBC, and asked the Shadows. I mean, we went to Storm, you know, Cliff and the Shadows, we went to Storm, and he asked the Shadows if we would be interested in representing Britain in the Eurovision Song Contest, which was a real big deal in those days, you know. You know, we take the Mickey now on stage and everything, but it was a big deal then. And more important, big artists used to appear in it. So, you know, Cliff's done it, as you know, and we've done it. But, you know, we could have, even Cliff Richard or the Shadows could have come last, because it is a competition. But it was a big deal, and so we said yes, and ABBA had won the contest the year before. So we went off to Stockholm and sang this song, Let Me Be the One.
Let me be the one who's loving you tonight. Let me be the one who really holds you tight. I'll even bring along a magic move.
We came second in the contest, but more important, it put the Shadows back in the singles chart, which we hadn't been in the singles chart for, I don't know, 10 years maybe?
Yeah. Bruce actually suggested we
play it
on stage as a feature for me, and I didn't like the idea at all because I thought, oh, I don't think it's going to work. So we talked about it. I said, OK, what we'll do, we'll rehearse it, we'll put it in the show. Well, first of all, rehearse it, and if it feels good, we'll put it in the show. And we'll try it out. And if it works in the show, fine. And that's what we did. And it pulled the house down every night. It was fantastic.
It's the only time we've ever had the audience actually shouting us to record it. And that's what happened, wasn't it? I mean, they would...
Yeah.
You know, a lot of the nights we were on the road saying, record it, record it. And we'd never had that before. So we did.
So we had this huge hit,
yeah.
And it was, I think it just took us all by surprise. You know, we didn't really believe it was going to be a hit record. We got this very nice letter from Jean-Michel Jarre, saying he was so thrilled that we'd recorded one of his compositions because he'd been a big Shads fan. And fun enough, later on, I did a track with him on the Revolutions album. And
you played in Docklands as
played
well,
in the
you?
Docklands thing with them, yeah.
You play anywhere, this guy.
Ah, do anything. And then I also, funnily enough, went to Paris to play at the centennial of the Eiffel Tower. He got all these photographs out from when he was a kid with his red Stratocaster and all that. He used to play in a Shads band. We're going to do a little piece of music now that I had the pleasure of playing with Dire Straits back in 1985. I appeared in all their London gigs on the Brothers in Arms tour to do this number. It's a great little tune. It's from a movie called Local Hero. And we want to play Mark Knopfler's composition, Going Home.
I saw the movie.
Bruce went to see the movie, that's right.
And said there was... I mean, you don't hear this tune. I just loved this small-budget movie, and I sat, as most people don't, I sat through the whole of the credits at the end, watching all the names, and this tune played, you know, that's when it came on. And it was just fantastic, you know, just a fantastic piece of music, and I told Hank about it.
He's got a good ear for a tune, Bruce, yeah. You see. It's this one. the end of the show. They'd virtually finished the show, and he invited me on, and we did this at the end of the show. And while we're playing it,
they dismantle it.
The technicians used to come and dismantle the stage, the microphones, and walk off.
It's the most brilliant ending to a show I've seen.
It's a great ending. Sort of striking, right? A bit like a dodgy restaurant, you know, where they're sweeping up and putting the tables up and you're still eating.
Brilliant.
But it was fun. I enjoyed doing it. It was a different version to the, you know, to our way of doing it, but nevertheless, it's such a great little tune. We knew in the 60s that we were having an impact on young men, and to a degree young women too, but mainly young men in terms of them starting to play instruments. And we'd meet guys who'd say, oh, we formed a band, you know, I've learned to play guitar. That's fine. But in the 70s, I met a few people then. That's when I first learned that the guys met some heavy metal guys at an airport, German band. Came, oh, Hank Marvin. You're the reason I started to play guitar. Take that. and then you meet other guys and say, oh, well, actually, you know, Hank, I started playing because of the Shads. I used to listen to the Shads and I wanted to play like that. And they've gone off into their own areas of expertise, whatever it might be now, blues, heavy metal, jazz, whatever. And gradually I started to realize the impact that we'd had as the Shads on people.
What I liked about the Shadows was that it was different. It was very clear music. And I just liked it.
It's melodic music and played beautifully.
Oh, the unique style of playing.
I just loved the guitar. So couldn't, you know, that was it for me. As soon as I saw the guitar, I just wanted to play one.
I like the style of guitar playing. I like the clarity of the notes and the tunes. I mean, they're clear. You can remember them, you can whistle them.
The sound, of course.
It's just different to everything else, and it just takes you away.
What can you say? Fender Strat, thing guitar.
I don't know, just the general Hank bit.
He makes the guitar sing, Hank. And I like Bruce, great rhythm guitarist.
I know, they're just great rock and roll band. I really liked them, so guitars.
Just the sort of different, they're different from any other band, really.
I just like the sound of the music.
Good music, you can really relate to it. Sorts all sorts of ages, really, from when you're a youngster, middle-aged. Old age, really.
You've, one, encouraged them to play a musical instrument, which I think is great. Some are semi-pros or amateurs now. They still play, they still enjoy it. Others have gone on and become stars in their own right.
Well, I was well known to the boys as a drummer anyway. I'd worked with Eddie Cochran, Gene Vincent. I'd been Marty Wilde's drummer, Tommy Steele's drummer, and I met the boys down the Two Eyes. So when Tony made a speedy exit, I was the one that they called. Yeah. I think that's right, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
No, we actually called Phil Seaman, but he wasn't available.
The other guys weren't on the telephone at the time. And I was just about to go into a show in the West End, which was called Stop the World, I Want to Get Off, with Tony Newley, as a pit drummer. You know, I'd done my touring bit and didn't really want to do it again, you know.
Well, you were getting on then. You were about 19.
I was 21. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it wasn't jumping up and down and saying, "Wow, you know, I've cracked it," because I'd done the touring, you know. So I think
you wanted to settle down.
I wanted to settle down. Yeah. I'm so pleased you called. And fees were mentioned, which are obviously very important. And that was it. I was on the road. I went straight to Blackpool to finish a summer season.
Yeah, yeah.
The first big hit that I had was Summer Holiday, and how that came about was that at the time I was very interested in orchestration and learning my craft as a composer, and I was doing a postal course at Berklee School of Music, and we were in Stockton on Tees, yeah, doing a pantomime.
Mm-hmm.
And the score for Summer Holiday had been written, but they hadn't got a hit. There wasn't a hit there. So Bruce came into the theatre about 2 o'clock in the afternoon to get ready for the show at 8 o'clock in the evening, as he does. And I was in the pit.
Tune up.
I was in the pit doing my proposal course, and he said, you know, da 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 da, and I just went, "We're going where the sun shines brightly," and it just all happened in about 20 minutes. And I said, "Is that all right?"
Well, they'd given us the brief, hadn't they? They said the next movie's going to be about some guys that go on a bus, you know, on a holiday. And it's just an obvious line. We're all going on a summer
holiday.
And
it was just I was in at the right place at the right time, you know.
And then you told him about that best bit that you wrote?
Bruce tells a story that I wrote the introduction, you know, what
one,
people sort of
two,
say... No,
three.
Do you mean the bit that goes... Da, 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 da? No, just before that, it goes... Brr-da. So...
These are the jokes.
These are jokes. These are the jokes. That was really the first song. That's how it came about. It's got a rough roadmap, and I sometimes get lost, you know, in about 6 minutes of it. And I've actually got seriously. I think last
you
night
need
was
sat nav.
Yeah, last night I found my way, but there are a few, you know. It's a bit like a beginning, it's like a story, really, you know. You don't want to spend it all too quickly. You want to just be interesting and be inventive, you know.
The audiences we've had have just been unbelievable in their warmth, they're sort of glad to see us, that sort of... And also at the end, of course, they're sad. You know, we've had sort of standing ovations most nights, and it's just, it is emotional, you know. And I think that the Palladium, obviously, which is the actual last one, will be more so. But, you know, I'm sure we'll go out there and do, it's a show. It's our show. But we've had a fantastic time, haven't we?
Oh, yeah.
Well,
yeah.
Well, I think the significant thing is that we together started off... Not just us, but there was Marty Wilde and Billy Fury and a couple of other guys. We kind of kicked off rock and roll in Europe, and maybe in the rest of the world outside America, because we learned our trade from the Americans, obviously. So for me, it's like a huge, long, very long chapter that's coming to an end. We're all alive, which is we're grateful for, but we'll probably never sing together again. So Cliff Richard and the Shadows, it's not only be their last tour, but my last chance ever to sing with the band that helped me to the bottom.
To the bottom?
Yeah. Things. They made a lot of very melodic sounds. If you think about Wonderful Land and Contiki, Foot Tapper, they were all... We were very much into the melodic side of rock and roll. But when Apache came out, it was so fresh and clean and in tune and melodic. And in fact, they were almost... They were really cheated out of a success in the States. They could have been very big in the States, whereas I never made the States. But that record happened to be covered by somebody else. And he used some tricky-dicky stuff on it, didn't he? And he had the hit with it. But to me, Apache is going to be a standout track forever. When you hear that introduction go, you think immediately of these guys standing, four guys standing there, getting ready to do their dance step.
110 deck. It was great being on board. Thank you very much. Absolutely wonderful.
It was wonderful.
Cheers, mate.
Fabulous to see you again. Thanks.
It was wonderful.
It was
a lovely evening.
It
was really fantastic. The concert was...
So this is the second time this week you've seen the Shads.
It is indeed.
I'm glad you came along tonight.
Couldn't stay away. Yeah, I had that feeling, because, I mean, if this is the last one, I wanted to be here. And, I had to be here.
Would you say that Hank Marvin was an inspiration?
Of course, yeah. I mean, we grew up with those guys, and it will always be the same. You know, it's magic to me. I could play every one of those songs. I wouldn't play them as well as Hank, you know, but I would play them, you know, because that was the Bible when we were growing up as kids.
King Osborne, King Gary, Society of Distinguished Songwriters, but a king is not as high ranked as a shadow.
I wanted to try to make it like a voice.
Yes.
And that's how it
came
about.
Exactly what it is. And Cavatina sounded fantastic.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. I still watch Hank's fingers and I think, oh, I don't do it that way. I didn't know he played that up there or down there, you know, those little things like that. But it's glorious to watch. You know, the magic thing is it sounds like
like him, you know. And it's not just Hank, it's Bruce and Brian too, you know. But, you know, that particular sound, there are certain notes in the repertoire which when Hank hits them, it's like, whoa, you know. It does something to you in here. Yeah, nobody sounds like that. Nobody.
This way, Silla. Good.
I can hardly believe it's the last time the Shadows will ever play, because if you think of what happened tonight, they are still so brilliant. They are so good at what they do. And the very fact that I'll never get a chance to sing with them again is horrifying. But as Hank said earlier, one of the press guys, never say never. So, you know, it gives me hope that maybe sometime in the future we can get to have a reason to get together. I sincerely hope we do. They're too good, I think, for us to lose them entirely. It's always been fresh because they know what they're doing. And that's half the secret, and they like what they're doing. So for me, it was a wonderful, wonderful evening, and I'm so glad that if this is the end, I'm so glad I was here to be able to at least get my pink jacket on and join them for the last one. Fantastic. I had a wonderful evening.
It's been a great experience, up and down, you know, lots of different things happening. The things we've done, there have been peaks and troughs. At the time, there have been some very difficult times to cope with. Lots of laughs, of course. But I suppose that's probably the way it is with most careers and most bands. I think the band is playing really well. Everyone is playing well. We're working the audience as well. And I think it's therefore important that we did this from the audience point of view, to kind of put it to bed. And from on a personal level, that we got back together and worked together. So, you know, any things that have been said in the past and things that have been implied, it can be pushed out of the window, and you know, things are back on an even keel again. And I think that's good from a personal point of view and from the public point of view.
I always miss playing. I don't miss travelling. I won't miss travelling, you know. But I have missed playing over the last 10, 15 years where I haven't played, you know. I've been doing a lot of writing, you know, composing for film and television. But as Hank just said, we're playing good, and we are, because there's nothing to prove. We've actually, you know, both the boys have got great techniques. Hank is playing better than he's ever played before. I feel as if I'm playing better than I did when I was 30, you know. Because there's nothing to prove, you know. You just sit and play how you are, you know.
I've had a fantastic time. And I, you know, when it's over, it'll, you know, I'll miss it. I'll be missing it.
It doesn't matter how many times I or we have played a tune on this tour, obviously at least, you know, 37 times with Apache. You go back over the years, thousands of times. For a lot of people in the audience, they see it once. I know there are some who come to a lot of shows, but most come to one show. And they may see you, if you're regularly on tour, once every 2 years. That's all. To them, it's a great experience. And so I learned to put myself into the position of someone in the audience. And how excited I would be if I see my favorite artist. Oh, I hope they do this, hope they do that. And when the artist does it, I hope they do it with enthusiasm and with real conviction and passion. And that's what I think we try to do. I've been trying to do this for years. Every time I play Apache or whatever, I play it as if this is my latest hit or our latest hit. Doesn't matter what it is. I want to put everything into it.
It is your latest hit.
Well, so the audience really believes, and you've got to make the audience believe that you believe in what you're playing. And I think we're doing that in this tour.
You can't fake it, really.